Welcome students. In this lecture we are going to do a few problems from the chapter of wave particle duality. The theory of this chapter was already covered in the previous lectures. So this will be the last lecture in this chapter where we will do some few problems. Remember, problems are very simple. You can easily score marks in problems, so do not leave any problems in your question paper. Okay, so I have picked up some questions from the problems from the previous year's question papers, and let's solve them. So the first problem: a photon of 2 angstrom units strikes an electron at rest and is scattered at an angle of 120 degrees. Find the wavelength and the speed of the photon after collision. Also calculate the Compton shift. So now this is the problem based on the Compton effect. Okay, so you know what is Compton effect? When incident radiation falls on the scatterer, the scattered radiation is found to have two components. One is the modified component and one is the unmodified component. The modified component has a wavelength greater than the incident wavelength, whereas the unmodified component has the same wavelength as the incident wavelength. So we have a body, we have an object, radiation falls on it, and the radiation which is coming out of it has two wavelengths. What is incident is only one wavelength, but what is coming out is lambda and lambda dash. Okay, so two components come out. This is something which is not expected by the classical theory. So lambda is called as the unmodified component because it has the same wavelength as incident, and lambda dash is called a modified component because it has a different wavelength. And it's always found that lambda dash is greater than lambda. This is always true whatever will be of incident radiation. The modified component always has a wavelength greater than the unmodified component. So in this problem, what is given to us? A photon of 2 angstrom units. So the incident wavelength is given to us. The incident wavelength lambda is 2 angstrom units, and scattering angle is given to us. Theta is given to us. So what's the formula we have for Compton shift? Compton formula is lambda dash minus lambda is equal to h upon m0c into 1 minus cos theta. Here lambda dash is the modified component, lambda is the unmodified component, theta is the angle of scattering, which is in this problem given as 120 degrees. What are we required to find out? We are required to find out lambda dash. Lambda is given to us. So this is lambda. Okay. So what will be lambda dash from this formula? Lambda dash will be equal to lambda, so lambda was the other side, so it becomes lambda plus h upon m0c into 1 minus cos theta. So we put the values here. Lambda is given to us as 2 angstrom units, so 2 into 10 raised to the power minus 10, I have converted it into meters, plus h is the Planck's constant, 6.63 into 10 raised to the power minus 34, divided by m0 is the mass of the electron, rest mass of the electron, which is 9.1 into 10 raised to the power minus 31, into c is the velocity of light, 3 into 10 raised to 8, into 1 minus cos of 120 degrees. Okay. So what is this answer coming out to be? 2.036 into 10 raised to the power minus 10 meters. Answer is in SI units because we have solved the entire problem in SI units. So this is the answer. If I want to convert it into angstrom unit, this is nothing but 2.036 angstrom unit, because 10 raised to the power minus 10 is 1 angstrom unit. So what do you see now? Incident wavelength is 2 and the scattered wavelength, modified component, is 2.036. So it's always true. So this relation holds. Lambda dash is greater than lambda. So you can always verify your answer by checking which of them is greater. Okay, lambda dash must always come out be greater than lambda. Next, we also need to find out the Compton shift. What is Compton shift? The difference between the modified and the unmodified wavelengths. So lambda dash minus lambda is called Compton shift, this quantity. So we have the value of lambda, and we have calculated the value of lambda dash. So what will be Compton shift? I'll do it over here. Compton shift is defined as the difference between the wavelength of the modified component and the wavelength of the unmodified component. So this will equal to 2.036 minus 2, which is equal to 0.036 angstrom unit. So this is the value of your Compton shift. Next problem. In a Compton effect experiment, the wavelength of X-ray radiation scattered at an angle of 45 degrees is 0.022 angstrom unit. Calculate the wavelength of the incident X-rays. So this is the same problem, but only thing this time we have to calculate the wavelength of the incident X-rays. Wavelength of the scattered radiation is given to us. So this is lambda dash. So lambda dash is given to us. We have to find what is lambda. Okay. So same formula applies here. So lambda S minus lambda is equal to H upon M0C into 1 minus cos theta. But this time we have to calculate what is lambda. So what is lambda from this formula? It will become, so lambda is taken other side. You can rearrange the terms and see. You will get it as lambda dash minus H upon M0C into 1 minus cos theta. So we'll put the values here. It is 0.022 into 10 raised to power minus 10 minus 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 divided by 9.1 into 10 raised to power minus 31 mass of electron and velocity of light 3 into 10 raised to 8 into 1 minus cos of what is the angle given? 45 degrees. So this answer will come out to be as equal to 0.0149 into 10 raised to power minus 10 meters. Okay, this will come out to be like this, which I can write it as equal to 0.0149 angstrom unit. Okay, so again you see lambda dash value is 0.022, lambda value is 0.0149 angstrom unit. So lambda dash is greater than lambda. So this answer is correct because I am getting the value of lambda lesser to be the value of lambda dash. Next problem. A photon of 1 mega electron volt is scattered through 90 degrees by a free electron. Calculate the energy of the photon and electron after the interaction. So what we have over here is a Compton effect problem. We remember what happens in Compton effect. Compton, how did he explain Compton effect phenomena? He said that in Compton effect, what is happening is actually light is not made up of a wave, but it made up of a particle called a photon. So what happens during the process of scattering? The photon, so we have here an object. We have here the object. What is falling on this object is radiation, but this radiation is made up of particles called as photons. And this photon is going and falling on the object. So what is it colliding with? This object inside has atoms. An atom has nucleus and electrons going around the nucleus. So what Compton said is that in the phenomenon of Compton effect, the photons come from the incident radiation, go and collide with the electrons. Inside this there is an electron. So during the collision what happens? The photon transfers some of its energy to the electron. And therefore the photon which comes out has a lesser energy. So it's like this. So this is the electron inside the object. This is the photon which is coming and colliding the electron. So the photon after collision, what will happen? It will come out. So if the incident photon had an energy E, what happens? This photon goes and collides with this electron. It transfers some of its energy to the electron. So it's losing, the photon is losing some of the energy to the electron. So the photon which will coming up, comes out, will have an energy E dash, which will be less than E. The scattered photon's energy will naturally be less than the incident photon's energy. Why? Because the photon is losing some of its energy to the electron during the collision. So what is given to us is E is given to us. The photon of 1 mega electron volt. So what is given to us is E is equal to 1 MeV. Okay. What are we required to find out? Calculate the energy of the photon after interaction, after the collision. So we are required to find out what is E dash. Also, we are required to find out the energy of the electron also. This electron which is there over here. How much is its energy after the interaction? So how will we calculate that? Remember, Where is the electron getting its energy from? The electron is getting its energy from the photon. So whatever energy the photon is losing, the electron will gain. So what will be the energy of the electron? Energy of the electron will be, electron's energy will be E minus E dash. What is E minus E dash? E is the energy of the incident photon. E dash is the energy of the scattered photon. So E minus E dash is the energy lost by the photon. And this energy lost by the photon is gained by the electron. So energy of the electron will therefore be E minus E dash. So all that we need to find in the problem is the value of E dash. Once we get the value of E dash, that's the scattered photon's energy, automatically the electron's energy also we can calculate. So let's try and solve this problem. First of all, energy E is given to us as 1 mega electron volt. Now, electron volt is not an SI unit. First we'll therefore need to convert it into SI unit, joules. So how do we convert it into joules? So this mega means 10 raised to 6. So 1 into 10 raised to 6. Next, electron volt has to be converted into joules. So for that we multiply with 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19. Okay. So this is how we convert from electron volt to joules. Multiply with E, small e, charge of electron. 1.6 10 raised to power minus 19. So this value will come out to be 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 13 joules. Now the value is in SI units. So now, our aim, remember, is to find out the value of E dash. What is the formula for E? Energy of a photon, the formula is H nu. But in the Compton's formula, Compton effect formula, what is the formula? Lambda dash minus lambda. So there, in that formula, wavelength is involved. In this formula for E, E is equal to H nu, frequency is there. So if you want to use Compton effect formula, Compton shift formula, we'll have to convert this formula in terms of wavelength. So I can write this as H C by lambda. Nu can replace with C by lambda. Okay, so replace frequency with wavelength. So from this now, E is known to us. So we can find out the value of lambda. What is the wavelength of the incident radiation, incident photon? Can be found out based on this formula. Okay, so lambda can be found out. So what is lambda? Lambda will be HC upon E. So this will be equal to 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by E is 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 13. So this answer comes out to be 1.234 into 10 raised to power minus 12 meters. It's wavelength. So this is the wavelength of the incident photon, lambda. Now from this, using the Compton shift formula, we can find the value of lambda dash. Okay? So what is the Compton shift formula? It is lambda dash minus lambda is equal to H upon M0C into 1 minus cos theta. We have used this in the previous problems. We have used this formula. So this is called the Compton shift formula. Now from this, what is lambda dash then? Lambda dash will be lambda plus H upon M0C into 1 minus cos theta. Okay? So now lambda value is known to us. This is the value of your lambda, and theta is given to us 90 degrees. So let's substitute and calculate the value of lambda dash. So lambda dash will be equal to lambda, which is 1.234 10 raised to power minus 12, 1.234 into 10 raised to power minus 12, plus H upon M0C, 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34, upon 9.1 into 10 raised to power minus 31 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 into 1 minus cos of 90. Okay? If you solve this thing, this answer will come out 3.67 into 10 raised to power minus 12 meters. Okay? So this is the value of lambda dash. Wavelength of the scattered photon. Now from this value of lambda dash, we can find the energy of the scattered photon E dash. How we do that? So finally, energy of scattered photon, this is what is the first part of the problem, energy of scattered photon E dash same formula, this formula here, using this formula, E is equal to hc by lambda. So similarly, applying it for E dash, E dash will be hc upon lambda dash. H and c are constants. So it becomes hc upon lambda dash. So 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by lambda dash, just calculated over here, 3.67 into 10 raised to power minus 12. And this answer comes out to be 5.42 into 10 raised to power minus 14 joules. Okay, answer comes out in SI units because everything is substituted in SI units. So what was the energy of the incident photon? Energy of the incident photon was this much here. You can see 1.6 10 raised to power minus 13 joules. Whereas the energy of the scattered photon is 5.42 10 raised to power minus 14 joules. Which is bigger? Incident was bigger. Why? Because this is 10 raised to power minus 13. Whereas it is 10 raised to power minus 14. So E dash is lesser. That was as expected, right? Incident photon comes and collides with the electron. It loses energy. So therefore the scattered photon has a lesser energy. So E dash is lesser than E. So this is the energy of the scattered photon. So we have found the first part of the problem. Find, calculate the energy of the scattered photon we have found out. Now this part is remaining. Calculating the energy of the electron. And already I told you how to find the energy of the electron. Is whatever energy is lost by the photon is gained by the electron. So E minus E dash. So energy of electron is equal to E minus E dash. So which is equal to, how much was E? 1.6 10 raised to power minus 13 minus 5.42 into 10 raised to power minus 14. And this answer comes out to be equal to 1.058 into 10 raised to power minus 13 joules. Okay, 1.058. Yeah, so 1.058 10 raised to power minus 13 joules. So this is other two answers which are required. This is the energy of the scattered photon and this is the energy of the electron after the collision. Last problem. Using the de Broglie's hypothesis, calculate the wavelength associated with a ball of mass 100 grams moving with a speed of 36 kilometers per hour and electron with kinetic energy of 100 electron volts. So now this is a problem based on the de Broglie's hypothesis. What does the de Broglie's hypothesis say? That every particle behaves like a wave. There is a wave associated with every particle. So whether it's a cricket ball, whether it's an electron, any particle, any object which is around us, including you and me, all of us behave like waves. So every wave has a wavelength. So if we are behaving like waves, if the ball is behaving like a wave, what is its wavelength? So that's what the problem is asking over here. Okay, calculate the de Broglie's wavelength of the wave associated with, so there are two parts here, wave associated with the ball and wave associated with the electron. So how do we find out that? There's a formula for de Broglie's wavelength. What is the formula? You can refer to the theory. Formula for de Broglie's wavelength is lambda is equal to h upon p. H is the Planck constant, p is the momentum of the particle. Okay? This formula can be rewritten or simplified as h upon mv because momentum is mass into velocity. And further, this formula can also be written as h upon root of 2me. So all these formulas were there in the theory. You can refer to the theoretical part and see how we got this h upon root of 2me, because p, momentum p, can also be written in terms of kinetic energy as root of 2me. Momentum p is also equal to root of 2me. How we get that, you can refer to the, while discussing this theory of the de Broglie's wavelength, I had shown you how we get this formula, root of 2me. So what is E there? E is the kinetic energy. Now why all these different formulas? Depending upon what is given in the problem, you have to choose the appropriate formula. Okay, so for example, in the first part of the problem, mass of the particle and the speed of the particle is given to us. So which formula can use? H upon mv. Lambda is equal to H upon mv can be used to determine its wavelength. For the second part, the kinetic energy of the electron is given to us. Velocity and mass is not given. Mass we know, no doubt, but velocity is not given. But energy is given. Since energy is given, we can use the this formula, H upon root of 2me, to calculate the wavelength. So depending upon what is given in the problem, you can use the appropriate formula. So for the first part, for the ball, what formula are you going to use? Wavelength lambda is equal to H upon m into v. Now, mass is given as 100 grams. It is better to solve this problem in SI units because there are two quantities there. So we'll try to get everything in SI units and then solve it. So what is given? Mass is given as 100 grams. Now grams is not an SI unit. Kilograms we have to convert it to. So 100 grams is equal to 0.1 kilograms. So multiply with 10 raised to minus 3. 1 gram is 10 raised to minus 3 kilograms. So 0.1 kilogram. Also velocity is given to us as 36 kilometers per hour. Now kilometers per hour is again not an SI unit. What is the SI unit of velocity? It is meter per second. So this I can write it as equal to 36 into 5 by 18. Okay, 5 by 18. So that's the conversion factor. Kilometers per hour to meters per second is conversion factor is 5 by 18. So this will come up to be 10 meters per second. So now with this values we can solve this problem. So 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34. Divided by 0.1 into 10. Okay, so this answer will come out 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 meters. Wavelength, SI unit of wavelength is meters. In the last part, to find, so second part is to find the wavelength for the electron. For the electron, which formula are we going to use? We are given the kinetic energy of the electron, so energy is given to us, so this thing is the energy, E, so we are going to use the this part of the formula, H upon root of 2me, so lambda is equal to H upon root of 2me. Now, so let's substitute this, so 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 divided by root of 2 into mass of electron is 9.1 into 10 raised to power minus 31 kilograms. Now, energy E is given to us as 100 eV, electron volt. Electron volt is not an SI unit. We need to convert it into joules. So 100 into 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19. Now, this will be in joules. So this comes out to be 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 17 joules. Okay, so this is the value of E we must substitute over here, 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 17. And the last answer which you get is 1.23 into 10 raised to power minus 10 meters. So this is the value of wavelength of electron. So we have calculated wavelength of ball and wavelength of electron. Just the last comment on this. Wavelength of the ball you see is 10 raised to power minus 34. It's a very, very, very small value. It's almost impossible to measure it with any measuring instrument. So what does it tell us? That even though a ball behaves like a wave, its wave nature is almost impossible to detect. Okay? So large objects like a ball or human being or any big objects which we can directly see, they also behave like waves, but their wave nature is insignificant. It's impossible to detect it. Whereas for an electron, you can see its wavelength is 10 raised to power minus 10 meters. Compared to the size of the electron, this wavelength is quite large. So electron does behave like a wave. It shows a significant wave behavior. Okay. So which are the particles which show wave nature? Everyone exhibits a wave nature, but only subatomic particles, very minute particles like electrons, protons, neutrons, only their wave nature can be detected, can be observed. Whereas macroscopic objects like human beings, big objects, cricket ball, any other big object which we see around us, their wave nature is impossible to detect, but they do also behave like waves. So De Broglie's hypothesis holds true for all objects, whether we see them or we do not see them. Okay. So with this, we end the problems in this chapter. Thank you.